It is my privilege to welcome you all to this memorial service in honor of Karen Bourne Smith, wife of Mike, mother of Bryce and Gretchen, a dear friend to us all. As we remember Karen's life, it's fitting that we do so as we worship her Savior, our Lord Jesus Christ. Karen was and is a Christian, a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. She knew him to be her creator and also her redeemer. We remember her life, and as we do, we give thanks and praise to our Savior and her Savior. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we gather together before you this day to give thanks to you for the life of Karen Smith. All glory and honor and majesty and dominion be unto you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We ask that you be with us in this hour of worship, that you fill us with your Holy Spirit, that we might worship you aright, and grant us comfort by your Spirit of comfort, that we might be a comfort to one another. This we ask in the great name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Karen, as you well know, those of you who knew her well, loved to worship her Lord, and especially on the Lord's Day when she was gathered with God's people. As she did, she united her voice with the voices of her brothers and her sisters in Christ in song and also confessing her faith. She regularly recited the Apostles' Creed on the Lord's Day, a summary statement of the Christian faith from the second century. With this confession, we unite our hearts and voices stating what we believe about our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In this confession, we confess that God created us, that Jesus has redeemed us, and that the Holy Spirit unites us to the body of Christ. In this confession, we rejoice in the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and we look also to that great day of resurrection to come. So I ask you to join me, if you know this confession or have a copy of it that you could read, would you join me now in reciting the Apostles' Creed? Christian, I ask you, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Karen, our sister in Christ, is yet at this very moment united to Jesus, her Savior, and also to his body. As she was a member of the local church here on earth, she is yet at this very moment a member of Christ's church, triumphant before the throne of our Lord Jesus in heaven. And there she waits in glory. On earth, Karen was a member of Liberty Presbyterian Church in Sylvania, and most recently a member of Trinity Presbyterian Church in Statesboro. These two churches belong to the Presbyterian Church in America, whose confession is the Westminster Confession of Faith, the Shorter Catechism of which addresses Karen's present condition in the presence of Jesus, and that which is to come at the resurrection when Christ returns. These two questions put before us the reality of what Karen is now experiencing, what we hope to experience one day as we follow her, and what we will all experience together as believers when Christ returns at the resurrection. Question number 37 asks this: what benefits do believers receive from Christ at death? The answer given is this: the souls of believers are at their death made perfect in holiness and do immediately pass into glory, and their bodies, being still united to Christ, do rest in their graves till the resurrection. Karen is now in the very presence of the Lord Jesus. She has been made perfect in holiness, and she does now dwell in the presence of Christ's glory. Question number 38 asks about what benefit do believers receive from Christ at the resurrection. The answer given is this: at the resurrection, believers, being raised up in glory, shall be openly acknowledged and acquitted in the day of judgment, and made perfectly blessed in the full enjoying of God to all eternity. These are the blessings that Karen, our sister in Christ, presently enjoys in the presence of Jesus, and these are the blessings that yet await her and all who hope in Christ at the day of his resurrection. Karen is yet united to Jesus, her Savior, and to his body, and she was a member of the local church here on earth. She is yet a member of Christ's church, triumphant before his throne in heaven. Let us now look for comfort from God's holy word. The psalmist tells us about the brevity of life in Psalm 90, some selected verses. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were born, or you gave birth to the earth and the world, even from everlasting to to everlasting, you are God. You turn man back into dust and say, return, O children of men, for 1,000 years in your sight are like yesterday when it passes, or as a watch in the night. You have swept them away like a flood. They fall asleep. In the morning they are like grass which sprouts anew. In the morning it flourishes and sprouts anew. Toward evening it fades and withers away. As for the days of our life, they contain 70 years, or if due to strength, 80 years. Yet their pride is but labor and sorrow, for soon it is gone and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may present to you a heart of wisdom. Hear these great words of comfort and hope from our Lord Jesus Christ, recorded for us for our benefit and encouragement in the Gospel according to John. In John chapter 10, verses 11 to 15, our Lord Jesus states these comforting words. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who is not the owner of the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he is a hired hand and is not concerned about the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own, and my own know me. Even as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And in the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John, as Jesus deals with the death of his good friend Lazarus and gives comfort to his sisters, Mary and Martha, in John chapter 11, verses 23 to 27, Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, even he who comes into the world. And then in John chapter 14, our Lord Jesus gives comfort to his disciples as they anticipate his leaving and speaks words of comfort which bring comfort to us as well as we anticipate that one day we shall be with him. John 14 verses 1 through 6. Do not let your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, for I go to prepare a place for you. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How do we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God endures forever. Amen.
I'm Greg Massey, I'm Karen's grandson, and I would like to read Psalm 46, which is one of her favorite passages. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. The nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our fortress. Come behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress.
Let's pray. Father, as we come to remember Karen, we thank you for her life and testimony and the blessing that she was to each one of us. And Father, we pray that you would bring comfort and strength to her loved ones in this time. We ask, Lord, that they might know that she is now in your presence and her joy is unparalleled. Father, we thank you for the sure promise that the moment her eyelids closed in death, Her soul was made perfect in holiness and did immediately pass into glory. So comfort and strengthen us with this truth, we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
For those of you who don't know me, I'm Clark Bourne. I'm Karen's brother. And on behalf of the family, we'd like to take this opportunity to thank Warren Baptist Church for making this presentation possible, for Trinity Presbyterian, Pastor Roland Barnes, and for Pastor Jim Hope, and all those who showered love on us during our time of need. And it's just a real privilege and an honor, but it's a very difficult one, to have this opportunity to share a few words about Karen on behalf of the family. This was my big sister. You know, she picked me up by my ears when I was little. She smashed potato chips on my head. I endured the typical little brother abuse from her. She taught me how to play the guitar, and she gave me my first and only body wave, which in my opinion ruined my senior pictures. As is typical for the oldest child, Daddy was hardest on Karen. You know, high expectations, early curfews, boys. However, she told me that it took our dad's death for her to come to the place where she got serious with her relationship to Christ. And her hunger for Christ grew over the years. She worshiped through Bible studies, through singing, playing the guitar. She was in women's church leadership. But the highlight of her spiritual journey was, I think, her and Mike's trip to the Holy Land, which was led by one of her favorites, Michael Card. And I loved hearing her talk about the friends that she and Mike made and seeing the photos and comments of the spiritual insights that she gained from that experience. And Karen, she constantly had the strangest things happen to her. And we'd always say, well, that could only happen to Karen. A few examples. When she was a teenager, she worked as a lifeguard, and she knocked out her front teeth doing a backflip off the diving board. And she was the only person in the pool at the time, and she didn't even remember how she got out of the pool. Once when she was playing a song in church, she apologized because she had broken her G-string. She was talking about her guitar's G-string, but needless to say, that got quite a chuckle. Now, Karen was a great cook. We were at Mom's house for Christmas one year, and Karen said she would bring the ham. And when Chris, my wife, was slicing it up, she hit something hard, and she thought it was a bone. And she looked down, and she saw it was a tooth. And then a tongue. It was the hog's head. And who keeps a hog's head in their freezer that could ever even be mistaken for a ham? She never lived that one down. And once while driving a plant shipment to Augusta, her flip-flop got hung under the accelerator, and she ended up rear-ending the person in front of her. Insurance rates in Scriven County are high because of the number of deer that Karen hit while driving. And it's the main reason that she and Mike drive Volvos, because of their safety record. Now, right after Karen had colon surgery, Chris and I went down to visit to help Mike and Karen transition to their new house. And while we were there, they were going to spend their first night in the new house. And Mike wanted to carry Karen across the threshold, and he wanted us to document it. And when he swept her up, his knee gave out, and they fell flat out on the porch, legs sprawling everywhere. Once we made sure they were okay, we had one of the best laughs ever. But, you know, she was always able to laugh at the difficult things that happened to her. And her life was definitely not always easy. But her response to life's challenges is one that we can learn from. Missionary Amy Carmichael said, "It matters little what happens to us. The thing that really matters is how we react to what happens. The things that trouble us will pass in time, but our reactions have eternal consequences." In Proverbs 31:25 says, "She is clothed with strength and dignity. She can laugh at the days to come. She speaks with wisdom, and faithful instruction is on her tongue." We shared a love of Christian music, and we enjoyed playing our favorite songs together. And we'd always talk about, you know, have you heard this song, and just enjoy playing together. And she was always so excited to share a powerful song, and she was always willing and relished the opportunity to play a song in church. And she seemed immune to stage fright. She was confident and comfortable with who she was, and just so genuine. And she put people at ease. She's very unassuming and so laid back. You know, her worship through song was the outcry of a grace-filled heart. We mentioned Michael Carr was one of her favorite musicians and Bible teachers. And there's so many songs that were special to her. I think of El Shaddai and Chorus of Faith, A Joy in the Journey, The Poem of Your Life. And the lyrics in these songs describe how we're God's masterpieces, and our life is a song, and it's a poem with meaning. It's a life meant to be lived out and seen. Each moment of our lives, whether in times of great joy or times of great sorrow and sadness, are the rhythm and rhymes of our lives. Karen praised God with the song of her life. Psalm 28:7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy, and with my song I praise him." And this challenges me. What's the song of my life? When the Lord is my strength and my shield, when my heart trusts in him, he helps me. And my response is a heart that leaps for joy and praise him with the song of my life. But the Holy Spirit was so evident in Karen's life, and everyone could hear the song of her life. Our times together were way too short, and I often feel guilt over not being able to spend more time with her. And I mentioned this to Bryce after Karen passed, and he assured me with great wisdom, she was not sitting around waiting on us. There was so much going on in her life and so many people who she interacted with and blessed on a daily basis. And so many were touched by her kind, sweet, and genuine spirit. Our Uncle Bill Bourne shared a handwritten note that he received after his wife, Aunt Jenny, passed away 7 months ago. And he keeps it pinned to his drawing table. He's an artist, so he can read it every day. And it says, "Grief never ends, but it changes. It's a passage, not a place to stay. Grief is not a sign of weakness, nor a lack of faith. It is the price of love." So, Karen, we loved her, and we grieve now because we miss her, and our lives on this earth will never be the same. They can have a huge hole. But we don't grieve like the rest of the world, who have no hope. Hope has a name, and it's Jesus Christ. And Karen wouldn't want one person listening today to miss out on having this hope. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and no one comes to the Father except through him. So we love you, KB.
Oh.
It was my privilege to be Karen's pastor for some 17 years. And as we come to remember her today, it's my desire that God would be honored and we would be blessed as we think back over how God used her to bless us. I thought about what I might say this morning. There were three things that stood out about Karen that I'd like to focus on as we remember her. One is her faith. A second is her joy, and then finally, her love. First of all, in terms of her faith, I don't know if Karen had a life verse, but if she did, I think it would probably be Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Certainly, in the time of her death, we know that she enjoyed that gain that we can only imagine. But for her life, we can see that to live was Christ. I don't doubt but that there were some people that greeted her in heaven, thanking her for how she had been a part of making it possible for them to go to heaven. There were people here in the area that she witnessed to and demonstrated the love of Christ to that came to Christ through her. There are people in Africa, though, that because of her support of Hope Builders, they got to hear the gospel, and they believed that gospel and now are in heaven, having passed away before her. So she was a person of faith. I'm sure that demonstrated itself throughout her final days. But it demonstrated itself throughout her life. As her pastor, I was thrilled to see her express that faith in song. I was speaking with Bryce earlier about how I remembered she sang El Shaddai so often there in church and other songs of faith. So she had that faith that spoke of her joy in the Lord, that joy that is mentioned in Philippians chapter 4. Verses 4 and 5, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your gentleness be made known to all people. She was a joyful person. She loved to rollerblade. She loved to sing. She loved to help others. I remember so often going down to the farm there, and there would be people there that were kind of down and out that she and Mike were helping out. And that was a joy for her and him. That was a blessing that she thrilled to exercise. So she was a person of faith and joy. She was also a person of love. 1 Corinthians 13 says, love is patient. Love is kind. Love does not vaunt itself. Certainly, Karen was a person of great patience. I think you have to be if you're going to grow plants. I told my wife, I don't plant things, I bury them. But she had that green thumb that she could grow so much did so well at that. But she was kind, as I mentioned earlier, so many people that were kind of down on their luck, she helped out. She was kind and gracious. And she never vaunted herself. It was never about Karen. It was always about others. I saw that in so many ways. One of the things that struck me about her, again, going back to her faith, If she and Mike were not present at Wednesday night for prayer meeting, I knew something was wrong, because she enjoyed being there with the fellow saints and praying for other people. As she could, she joined in worship with us by singing special music. She and Mike were always there again on Sunday morning. If they weren't, we knew something was wrong. She was a person of great faith. And so as we come to remember her today, let's do so by thanking God for the grace he showed to her and through her unto us. Our lives are better because we knew Karen Bourne Smith. Let's pray. Father, again, we come before you to thank you for how you have blessed us so many times in so many ways through Karen. She was indeed a blessing to each one of us. Again, we thank you that she is now with you, enjoying your presence. Again, I would pray for your comforting mercies for each member of her family and for all of her friends. And I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Christ the sure and steady anchor in the fury of the storm. When the winds of doubt blow through me and my sails have all been torn. In the suffering, in the sorrow, thank you.
Would you receive now the benediction? Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.